I'd like to introduce Dr. Cindra Kamphoff from the University of Minnesota at Mankato. Am I still close, Cindra? I think you're unmuted. That's great. And I'm going to also spotlight you, Cindra, so people can hopefully see you a little better in what we're doing. Did that come out okay? There we go. So go ahead, Cindra. We'll let you take it away. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thanks, Manny. And thank you, Terry. I'm really excited to be here today. My name is Cindra Kamphoff. And one of the things I know Manny was going to talk about related to what I do is I'm a performance coach, an executive coach, and a speaker, obviously. And I have worked with a wide variety of people. In fact, I provided mental training to the Minnesota Vikings. I'll talk a little bit about that and still work with the players there. And also have spent the summer working with the United States track and field team. And I have a book called Beyond Grit. So I want to start actually with a story that really inspired me at the Olympic Games. And first, what I love for us to do is we're going to make sure that we use the chat a lot today. Because if I was in person with you, I really thrive on you and your feedback and your interaction. And so we're just going to pretend we're in person, okay? And the way that we're going to do this is we're going to use the chat, all right? So if you could find the chat on the bottom, okay? And I will too. I'm just going to end my slide a minute so that I can actually see the chat and pull it up here, okay? So just give me a second to find that so I can open it up. And in the chat, what I'd love for you to do is tell me if you watched the Olympics. Okay, did you watch the Olympics? Go ahead and tell me in the chat if you watched the Olympic Games. Okay, you can just say yes or no. Here we go. We got some. Okay, Heather said I watched the Olympics. All right. So we're going to use this chat actually so that I can hear you and I can connect with you throughout our conversation. So one of the stories that really inspired me was Allison Felix. So Allison Felix is 35 years old. She just became America's most decorated track and field athlete. Her first Olympic Games was 17 years ago. And I was, you know, in my work with the USA track and field team, I call them, I do Zoom calls with them while they were in Tokyo. And one of the things I know about Allison Felix is that in her final individual race in the 400 meters, she was in fourth. And if you know anything about the Olympics, the top three win a medal. In the last 20 meters when she was in fourth, she tapped into her grit. And she thought about all the reasons that all the things that she had overcome to get to the Olympics this year. See, she was pregnant 2 years ago with her daughter. And she had pregnancy complications. She didn't know if she would, her daughter would actually live. At one point, Allison Felix couldn't even walk. And in that 20 meters, the 400 meter race, she thought about the difficulties that she had overcome. She thought about what it was like to go from walking to running again. She tapped into her purpose to help her be a strong role model for other women and mothers who want to be athletes. And she actually tapped into kind of wanting to prove Nike wrong. So Nike reduced her compensation as an elite athlete by 70% because when she was pregnant. So in this split second of this 20 meters, she tapped into her purpose and her grit. And she won a bronze medal. Again, her 10th medal. So we might not be elite athletes, but today what we're talking about is actually how we all need grit. And grit is our ability to persevere. It is our ability to stay passionate about what we're doing and to really think about our purpose and why we do what we do. It's all of these three P words connected to our future. And we all actually need something that we're excited about. We all need something that, despite how old we are, what our age is, it is proven by research that we need something to look forward to. And when I think about Allison Felix, right, a core of grit is actually optimism. It is a core pillar of grit. And, you know, to me, what optimism really is in that moment, she was optimistic. She tapped into all of these things that make her tick. There's other women that really inspired me during the Olympic Games. And in the chat, tell me if you saw this race. It was a race in 400 meter hurdles. Two women were battling it out, making each other actually better. One had actually broken the world record right before the Olympics. And so they were battling it out, Muhammad and her name is Sydney McLaughlin. And in this race, Sydney just out, like at the end, right? Out, I guess, what would you say? Out finished Muhammad. And they both broke a world record. So by displaying grit, actually, we can make each other better. And they don't train together, but even though they're competitors, they bring out the best in each other. Now this year during the Olympic Games, we also saw a large display of the importance of mindset and training your mind, which I actually think that's what you do as optimists. You continually train your mindset. And if you're taking notes, I would love for you to write this note down. Hey, I'd love for you to write that our mindset is here to help us thrive, not just survive. That's why you choose to be in this club. And that's why you're here, right? Because you know the importance of training your mind. We know, as Terry mentioned at the beginning, the research that shows why optimism makes a difference. If you're an entrepreneur, optimism actually shows that you have higher profits. Optimists live longer. They perform better. They make more money, okay? They have less stress and less pressure and more confidence and resilience. And these are all things that, as a performance coach, to really help people be at their best, right? To train our optimism, to train our confidence, and to train our resilience. So, and I tell me in the chat that all you felt in the last 18 months if you just were surviving, okay? If you were, just give me a yes in the chat, okay? If you felt in all in the last 18 months that you were just surviving, let me know that in the chat, because I felt like that. And I have all these mindset tools and strategies, right? And I had to make sure I was practicing it more than any other time in my life. And this idea of training your optimism and training your mindset is not like riding a bicycle, okay? So in the chat, if you could tell me, how old were you when you learned to ride a bicycle, okay? And you, by the way, in the chat, you can either send this directly to me or you can put it so everyone can see. Okay, so if you'd like just to send me a private message, I got it open and I can see you. So Stephanie says 4, Gary says 5, Barb says 6, Denny said 6. Okay, yep, and I see some other things just like, yeah, it felt like it was survival mode. Jerry said 5. So most people probably learn to ride a bike when they're 5. And so you might think this idea of training your mind and training your optimism is like riding a bicycle. Okay, but it's not. We need daily practices every day to train our mindset and train our optimism. We have a negativity bias, which means we're more likely to see what's wrong and we're more likely to see the things that haven't worked out for us. In fact, negative events get stored more quickly and they linger longer. This is our biology, okay? So this is why we really need to train our mind and train our optimism every single day. And it's not like riding a bicycle. So what I mean by that is in the chat, tell me why, you know, even if you learned to ride a bicycle when you were 5, why do you think you could likely ride the bicycle today? Maybe just give me some answers in the chat. Why do you think that is? Why do you think that you could ride a bicycle even though you learned it, you know, many years ago? Let's see what people have to say here. Okay. Yeah, because I've done it before, because it's balance memory, because it's muscle memory, it's repetition. Absolutely. Repetition is the mother of mastery, right? Just continuing to get great at it. It takes repetition. Oh, okay. Joel said he continues to ride it today. Love it. Maybe some of you rode your bicycle today. So you might think this idea of training your mindset, training your optimism is like riding a bike, like it gets muscle memory, but it is not. It takes daily effort, daily intention, and really routines that help you be your best you. Now, you likely saw during the Olympics, if you were following the news at all, these athletes who have really continued to speak out about the importance of mindset and the importance of caring for our own mental health. Now, I think the power of this conversation is that more and more people are talking about mindset and mental health. And mental health, by the way, doesn't mean mental disorder, or it doesn't mean mental illness. And Simone Biles, if you were watching at all, withdrew from the American, the all-around competition in the Olympics. And she cited the case of the twisties, which meant that while she was in the air, her mind was not connected to her body. And so she would just get disoriented in the air. Now, likely this came from stress and pressure, right? And she did say that she felt like she had kind of this weight of the world on her shoulders the day before. And so these women and men like Michael Phelps and Naomi Osaka, she's a tennis player, have spoken out saying, we need to make sure that we're caring for our own mental health. And mental health just means that we all have mental health. We all, it's like physical health, right? We all have it. And we need to make sure we continue to take care of this, because this operates everything. And all of our minds are connected to our body, right? We can't do anything without this mind. And so I just want to point that out, because a lot of people are talking about it. If I was face to face with you, you'd probably ask me what I think about Simone Biles. And I think that she's a hero, because she is starting this conversation worldwide about the importance of our mindset and taking care of our own potential. So as we kind of dive into some of the practices today from my book and to help us continue to build our optimism, I would love for you to find the chat and tell me how old were you, or tell me what is potential, okay? What do you think potential means, okay? And if we were face-to-face, I'd ask you to turn to the person next to you, but we're going to use the chat instead. So tell me what you think the word potential means. Okay, what does the word potential mean? Okay, love these answers. Gary says untapped energy, unrealized capability. Capability, Joel said, absolutely. Heather says willingness to learn, an opportunity to continue to grow, positive possibilities. Ability and desire. Thank you, Maria. What else do you think is this word potential? Any other answers here? I love all these answers. So I ask you this question to help you think about your own potential. Okay, what is your potential? And what are the opportunities for you coming up? If it's unlimited possibilities, what does your potential look like? If it's the ability to excel, what is in your future? Very few people actually know the answer to that question. What do you really, really want? And what are you going after? So I'm going to answer this question, what is potential? Because optimism, right? As we think about cultivating our optimism, I think optimism is a key part of reaching our potential. And what I mean by potential is, I mean, I'm going to decide to say it is unlimited and endless. Okay, our potential is unlimited and endless. There are so many possibilities for us. And I absolutely love this quote by Ralph Waldo Emerson. And he said, the only person you are destined to become is the person you decide to be. Okay, the only person you are destined to become is the person you decide to be. So when we think about your own potential, right, it's really us deciding what our potential is, and us every day working to reach our potential. No one else can determine our potential. It's really up to us. And what I have found from working with some of the best athletes in the world, and I work with a lot of entrepreneurs and even Harvard doctors and lots of different people, that the best are really always seeking what their potential is. So now what I'd love for you to do, let's answer this question in the chat, because I feel like I'm talking to you, okay? What do you think gets in the way of us reaching our potential? Okay, what do you think gets in the way of us reaching our potential? Yes. Okay. Terry says our mindset, procrastination. So maybe things that don't, habits that don't fill us or fill our bucket, mindset, fear of failing, fear of failure, our minds, anxiety, identity, sure, how we identify, maybe fear of failure. Yes, could you send me the quote again? Yes, okay, I'll put distractions. Okay, lack of focus, lack of fear, maybe time, energy. Absolutely, all these things coming in the chat, I would say, get in the way of our potential. And there are maybe some external things and our response to those external things that might impact our potential, but it really is our response to these events that happen, right? Bad habits, I see another example here coming in the chat. You know, when I work with people one-on-one, I see that there are external barriers to potential and internal barriers. But honestly, the majority of these barriers to our potential are internal. And so I want to remind you, and I'll put that quote up again for someone who asked in the chat. The only person you are destined to become is the person you decide to be. The only person you are destined to become is the person you decide to be. At the end today, we're going to talk about what are some beliefs that you need to level up so that you reach your potential. And I'm going to give you an example of an Olympian that I worked with this summer to inspire you to think about, what do I need to continue to believe about myself to reach my potential? But as we kind of dive into some of these ideas to help you continue to think about your potential and what that looks like, I'm gonna talk about a few of these practices from my book called Beyond Grit. And I'm working on a second book that should be out in January called Beyond Grit for Business. So it's specifically how these 10 practices relate to business and sales and entrepreneurship. We're going to cover a few of these. We're going to talk a little bit about grit. We already mentioned it a little bit. That's practice number one. We'll talk a little bit about our purpose and just reminding ourselves why we do what we do. Because as Terry said at the beginning, when we understand our why, that helps us be more optimistic. And then we'll talk about a few other practices here. And if you want to, by the way, download this, I'm going to go ahead and put this link in the chat. All right. And you can download it here at beyondgrit.com. There's a slash bonus. Okay. So beyondgrit.com/bonus. And there's a lot of people that I know who print this out and keep it right by their desk because these practices are things we're not born with. Okay. We actually have to practice them. And because of this negativity bias, we're more likely to not practice them than to actually practice them. And some days, you know, to be honest, I feel like I'm really great at number two. And then, you know, then I, the next day I feel like, oh, I gotta do better at number two, or some days I'm great at number nine, but no, I need to, you know, do better on other days. So it's just that we're all a work in progress. And really the goal of all of this is to help us reach our potential so that we can continue to be high performers, right? This kind of daily pursuit of us being at our best so that we can reach our best more consistently. Okay, so let's dive into some of these principles, and I have some stories to really help us think about how do we apply them. And the first thing that I want to do here is talk about, if you look closely at this part here, okay, I'm going to go back to it, is practice number 9. It's called live and let go. And this is the one that I find a lot of people really struggle with. And I think that gets in our way of reaching our potential and gets in the way of us developing an optimistic mindset. And so I just wrote here on practice number 9, the world's best, that people are not perfect. They are kind to themselves, letting go of mistakes, and quickly after learning from them, and they decide to live life full out. And maybe you can think of people who really struggle with living and letting go. Maybe they're living in the past a lot, or they think just because this happened again, it's going to repeat, right? And again, that's our automatic negativity that keeps us safe. So I'm curious if any of you know who this woman is. Okay, put it in the chat if you know. I'm going to see who can guess it first, right? So let's see in the chat, who do you think this woman is? She is one of the stories I feature in my new book. There we go, Stephanie. All right, the owner of Spanx, Miss Minnesota 2021, Spanx Lady, Julie said. Does anybody know her name? Anybody know her name? She is the Spanx Lady, okay? So her name is Sarah Blakely. And she found herself in the 1990s selling copiers door to door. She really wanted to go to become a lawyer, but she failed the LSAT twice. So she found herself like selling copiers door to door. And this gave her actually great experience doing sales, but it gave her a lot of time to really think about what she wanted to do. And she wanted to do something with her entrepreneur spirit. She wanted to do something that really was built on her strengths. And one day she was getting ready for a party and she wanted to provide a smooth look under her white pants. And so she got her pantyhose out and she cut the bottoms of her pantyhose and provided this smooth, beautiful look. Well, what was happening is these pantyhose kept on rolling up all night, okay, underneath her white pants. And so that idea was the night that she discovered this brilliant idea of Spanx. And she said, everyone has a million-dollar idea inside them. And she said, you know, just like Edison said, that genius is 99% perspiration, right? Perseverance, and 1% thinking and creativity. And so her point was like, all of us have these million-dollar ideas, but we don't tap into them. Maybe we don't even believe that we're very creative, or we don't really give ourselves some time to really think about, gosh, what is it that I want to do? And she, by the way, now has over 100 employees, $250 million of revenue a month in her, or a year in her company, in Spanx. And she was the first woman to be named as the first self-made billionaire in the United States that's a female. And so she's the first female self-made billionaire. Now, the thing I want to share with you about this story is that she said that one of her key factors of success was every single night when she was growing up, her dad would ask her around the dinner table, how did you fail? So that was part of their dinner table routine, that they would go around the dinner table and they would say, how did you fail today? And you might think, what? You know, her dad would ask, how did you fail? But she said, because we were celebrating failure and we were thinking about failure, that when it came time to really, for me to go after this idea of Spanx, I didn't have fear of failure. And yes, it took a lot of grit. I mean, she took a lot of years to even building Spanx to become what it is now. But she learned to celebrate her failure and to move on that fast. So I want you just to kind of think about, what is failure to you? How do you define failure? As an optimist, how do you define failure? And this is important. We can define failure on our terms. And in fact, I think that we need to. So I have a podcast called The High Performance Mindset, and I've had it since 2015. There's almost 500 episodes. So you'll see a lot about me talking about optimism and these other mindset practices. Would love for you to check it out. And if you have checked it out, put it in the chat, all right? Because I know some of you listen regularly. And every expert I ask, I say, what does failure mean to you? And it's really interesting because guess what? All of these experts, they don't have one common definition of failure. And I want you to think about, what does failure mean to you? How can you define it on your terms? Here are some really interesting examples. One person said, it's just a delay in results. I had Jack Canfield on my podcast, who wrote the Chicken Soup for the Soul books. Maybe you know those. And he said, you know, failure is just anytime I fall, right? And instead of thinking like fail, we should just change that I to the L. And he said, you know, when we were younger and our parents were teaching us how to walk, they didn't tell us we failed. We just got right back up. And that's what he thinks that we should do when we, you know, make a mistake or there's a difficulty we experience. First attempt in learning. Maybe you've heard that, that acronym there for fail. Or I love this. This is a guy I interviewed who works with the Seattle Seahawks. His name is Michael Gervain. He's the sports psychologist there. And he said, failure is anytime I'm not being myself. That's the definition I've adopted. Anytime I'm not being myself, because all of us know that when we're ourselves, right, we're authentic, we can connect with each other. And that's actually when we're at our best. Here's a few others. Failure is anytime I just don't show up, or anytime I didn't go for it. So I want you to think about, what does failure mean to you? If we all, right, we all have this innate nature to fear failure, or maybe sometimes we might even fear success, and this fear gets in our way. But when we really condition our daily, condition our mindset to go for it instead and define failure differently, right, we can reach our potential. So put in the chat, who is your favorite Vikings player? Okay, I'd love for you to put in the chat, who, I know many of you watch the Vikings. Who's your favorite player? Go ahead and put that in the chat. What do you think? Okay. Oh, Gary says Thielen. Stephanie says Thielen. Do we got any others? Okay. Just Thielen. Okay. Did you all see my next slide? Because one of the, there we go, Paige Allen, Kirk Cousins. All right. One of the players that I've had the amazing privilege of working with, I met him 8 years ago, is Adam Thielen. And I've worked with a lot of different teams. And one of the football teams I work with is the Minnesota State Maverick football team. And I started working with them when Adam was a senior. And so if you don't know much about Adam's story, he grew up in Detroit Lakes, Minnesota, a really small town. If anybody knows what his scholarship amount was that he got to play football here at Mankato, go ahead and put that in the chat, okay? And he was a great player his senior year, but literally nobody thought he would make it to the NFL. Hey, he got a $500 scholarship. And I was talking to one of the coaches recently that was coaching during Adam's senior year, actually when they recruited Adam. And one of the coaches told me that they had talked about cutting Adam, that his freshman year, he just wasn't showing a lot of potential. Thank goodness they didn't cut him. And so last year when the Vikings were playing the Saints, okay, it was a game where we were at the Saints. And so, and really we were not expected to win, if you remember. And if you, there you go, Kurt says 500 here. If you were watching this game where the Vikings were playing the Saints, go ahead and put that in the chat, all right? Tell me if you were watching that game. So this game early on, Adam fumbles the ball. And a lot of people were watching that game and, fumbles the ball. The Saints just, pile on the ball and no longer do the Vikings have it. And obviously disappointing when a wide receiver fumbles the ball. And so an ESPN reporter saw Adam go over to the sidelines. Hey, and he kind of went like this. And Adam, next play, had a next play mentality, meaning he was able to move on that fast, be present in the next play, and let go of the fumble that quickly. And we all actually need this next play mentality, don't we? Where maybe I'm thinking, Terry, you're talking about this morning, how you had some difficulties, right? We need a short-term memory of those difficulties so that we can continue to be optimistic. We can take on any challenge that we experience. And so next play, Adam was in, forgot the fumble. And this next play mentality actually helped the Vikings win the game. So right at the last opportunity to score, Adam catches the ball 35 over his head. Gorgeous, right? Just a gorgeous pass and a gorgeous catch. And this catch helped the Vikings win. Now, Adam could have been still thinking about the fumble, right? He could have been replaying that in his mind as a way to kind of learn, right? But again, he had this next play mentality. So after the game, the Vikings or the ESPN reporter asked Adam, like, what was this about? And how did you move on very quickly? Now, I'm a little embarrassed to tell you what he said, okay? But this is what he said. I was flushing the toilet. And okay, so I got a little toilet here to catch your attention. And then I'm like, of course, this is how I get an ESPN. Mental coach taught Vikings Adam Thielen to flush away his mistakes. But that's actually what he was doing. He had a visual cue to move on very quickly. And in the book, my Beyond Grit book, I talk about the importance of learning and burning. That's what he was doing. He was learning, what will I do next time? But then he was burning. He was having a very short-term memory of his mistakes, right? And a long-term memory of his successes. So if you're taking notes, I'd love for you to write this down. A key pillar of optimism, right, is for us to quickly move on, to not to live and let go, or to live and let go. And so what I have found is the best have a very long-term memory of their successes and a short-term memory of their mistakes or their failures. And this is something, again, a lot of people really struggle with. Maybe you're saying, yeah, you struggle with this. I struggle with this at times. That's why we need mental practices to learn and burn, right? Or next time you're having a hard time moving on, you cleanse your Adam Thielen and pretend to flush the toilet. And by the way, this came because the senior year when I worked with Adam's team, Minnesota State, we actually had a tiny toilet that was a little bit bigger, and players would go over to the sidelines and flush the mistake if they needed to. So that's where the idea came from. So Adam wrote the foreword of my book, and he said this. He said, your best self is on the other end of your trail of grit, okay? And then he said, you know, if you never stop searching for what makes you the best version of yourself, then you'll take off beyond boundaries you never knew were there. And that's what I think potential is. Never stop searching for what makes you the best version of yourself. When you do that every single day, right? What is my best? How can I be my best today? How can I have the standard of excellence, whatever that means for me? You know, then you'll take off beyond boundaries you never knew were there. And if you would ask Adam's, you know, high school coaches, or obviously even the freshman year here at Minnesota State Mankato, if you would ask them, do you think Adam would, you know, get to where he is now? And likely they, I mean, I've talked to them and they said, well, he had a lot of potential. I think Adam was able and still is able to reach and tap into his potential because every day he's training his mind. Every day he's really searching for what makes you the best version of himself. So let's talk a little bit about this idea of grit, okay? If optimism is a key pillar of grit, by the way, grit has been described as a number one predictor of our success because it's connected to all of these things like more engagement at work, higher levels of leadership, better retention at work, entrepreneurial success, which I know many of you are entrepreneurs. If we're gritty, we are, here's actually the research, okay? And I could fill up four slides on this, okay? But I don't wanna give you too much, but really it means that, you know, grit is connected with our ability to be successful and we can actually train it. We can train ourselves to be more gritty. Because when we're grittier, we can adapt and we can change and grow. And all of these things are the outcomes of being more gritty. So this is actually what I'd love for you to write down or take notes about. Okay, and I'm gonna today share with you kind of five ways to grow your grit. And then the rest of our talk today is really about how to continue to help you grow this grit. Hey, and we need grit no matter if we're 18 or if we're 80, because we need things to keep moving towards, right? If we are not hopeful about our future, if we are disconnected with our future, we're gonna lack energy and lack optimism. And generally it's not good for our health. That's why we all need to really understand what is it that we really, 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 really want, okay? And I say that because few people really know what they want. They haven't spent the time and they haven't really reflected on it, right? And this takes time, this takes creativity, this takes reflection. Again, if you're 18 or 80, we all need something that we're working towards. So as you think about cultivating your grit, I want you to ask yourself, you know, what is it that you really, really want? Okay, what is it that you want in 2 years? What is it that you want in 5 years? What is it that you want in 10 years, right? Or maybe 20. And I would say that the best have these goals written down. I have my goals right behind me right there on my right. You can't see it, but right by the football. And every day I spend some time thinking about where I'm going and why I'm doing it. And so, you know, even if you do know exactly where you're going, are you able to put the most important things first in your day? Do you put the things that you are going after as kind of your pillars? right? Are you putting them as your most important things? Are you dedicating the time and attention that you need to moving towards those? Number two, it is powered by our purpose and owning it. And I've seen that the best athletes, the best leaders, they clearly know what their purpose is. They have a purpose statement. They tell other people about their purpose. They communicate it. The people that they work with, they know exactly why they do what they do. And you probably have seen the book or heard the TED Talk by a guy named Simon Sinek. And he talks about how the best companies start with their why. But I don't think you just need to start with it. You need to own it. So what that means is know exactly why you do what you do and remind yourself of it every day to stay fueled and excited and passionate and optimistic. So it's powered by knowing why you do what you do. It is, guess what? Here's where optimism comes in. It is fueled by these empowering emotions, right? Like optimism, confidence, and gratitude. And all of these things, these emotions are actually choices that we can make. And I want you to kind of think about emotions, how emotions are connected to your focus. Or a sticky way to say this you can write down is you can say, my focus determines how I feel. My focus determines how I feel. So if I want to feel more optimistic, I need to make sure my focus is on things that are leading to more optimism. And I want you to think about how your focus is like a spotlight. Okay, it's always on something, but is it on the things that really fuel you, right? Because our negativity bias is on the things that don't, right? The things that are wrong or the things that we don't have. It is ignited by your powerful commitment to your own self-talk every single day, right? And that's what optimists do, is they're telling themselves powerful things about themselves and about their potential. And then guess what? This last one, which we just talked about, related to Adam Thielen and Sarah Blakely. It is actually by your own compassion of yourself. And I used to think, by the way, that the more I beat myself, the better I would do. But I quickly realized that's not the case. And actually what the research shows is the kinder we are to ourselves, the better we're able to perform, the grittier that we're able to stay. So we talked a little bit about number five. Let's talk a little bit about number two, this idea of purpose. And as I'm talking, I want you to think about what is your purpose? And do you have it written down? Do you know exactly why you do what you do? And then we're going to talk a little bit about number four, our own thoughts. And so I get a lot of people asking me, you know, Cindra, you have a really unique job, which I do. You know, I work with these high performers and you know, they say, you know, how did you get into this profession? And my story actually started, here we go, in Sheldon, Iowa, right? And if you are from Iowa or have been to Iowa, you can put that in the chat. And I'm from Sheldon. So you can see in this picture, that I am running a race and it's the mile at the state meet. And in this race, it was my final race of my senior year. And I was able to win the race and run the fastest mile in Iowa that year. Okay, so this is, by the way, when we still had lines that you had to cross, okay? Like they still had rope. So it was a while ago. And so I am on this high, thinking and believing a lot in my potential. I just won the state meet. I just ran the fastest mile in the state of Iowa. Wow, what could I do? I could become an All-American. Wow, could I actually make it to the Olympics? And those were some of my goals. And so I got a full ride college scholarship to run at the University of Northern Iowa. And this is a picture, my senior year. They wrote it up in the paper, or it was actually my freshman year that I was on the right track at the University of Northern Iowa. And I had so much potential. Look at my really short hair. I was all into running. So I thought, more aerodynamics. I just cut my hair really short. And it was all about who I was. I was a runner. Everything I did I ate really great. I slept really great, right? I didn't have any unhealthy behaviors, and I worked out and ran a couple of times every day. I was ready to take on the world. And my physical ability might have even suggested that I could have become an All-American or an Olympian. But then what happened was I got in my own way. And my junior year, I really recall these couple of weeks that were really difficult. I did not live and let go. And there was a race, a local race in Cedar Falls, where I got second behind an All-American, first for my team, leading the way. And everybody said, Cindra, this is going to be your year. You are going to become an All-American. You just got second behind an All-American who's one of the best like runners in the country. And I was believing that it was possible for me. 1 week later, I'm racing at the GRIAC meet in Minneapolis. And I'm leading the way, just have been one of the top runners at the front of that race. And then all of a sudden, 5 people pass me, 10 people, 20 people pass me, 30 people pass me, 100 people pass me. And I felt defeated. I thought, there's no way I can do this. I'm, you know, wow, look at all these other runners. They're so much faster than me and fitter than me. And so that race, I dropped out. And I made up a story about an injury in my foot. My foot wasn't injured. It was more like my ego was injured. And I couldn't actually tell anybody that, hey, I was just struggling with my own mindset. I was struggling with my mental health. My confidence was just lower, and I didn't have the correct strategies or mindset to be able to persevere. Now I know, and this is a key pillar of optimism, is that we can change any meaning that we have in any difficulty, any situation, we can change the meaning about. And now I know actually that this happened for me, not to me. This is a powerful statement. Again, I'd love for you to write down, because there's a concept called crucibles, where these moments in our life that when we look back at, we can actually see the difficulty, we can see the gift, right? And we can see the opportunity. In the moment, it's really difficult, but I actually know this struggle happened for me because I would not be as passionate about what I do now. And it was so fun this summer to help these Olympians like just thrive at the Olympics, right? I was living through them and they, I was ready for them any moment that they had a question or they needed me because, right, I didn't reach my potential. And so when we think about it for, you know, to me, it's like, I'm such a, it's a victim, right? And I felt that way in college. Like, why me? I worked so hard. What's wrong with me? I didn't realize at the time that everybody can struggle with negativity. But for me is like, what's the opportunity here? What's the gift? So several years later, I decide to get back into running with this new mindset and this new toolbox. And just to see, gosh, what could I actually do now that I have this degree and I've been practicing and teaching all these mindset tools? So my journey back into running led me to the Boston Marathon. And there's something about Boston. It's the history of Boston that makes it extra special. And the course is really difficult because you run down 13 miles downhill. Okay. And that sounds awesome, but you get to the middle and your quads are already just hurting and you have to run uphill, series of 5 hills to Heartbreak Hill. And this particular year, I crushed the race. I used all my mindset tools. One of the first Minnesotans to pass through this finish line. And I'm like, this is it. This is what it feels like to reach your potential, where your physical ability is equal to your mental ability. And you're using all of these tools, right? To be in the present, to live and let go, to be optimistic, and to stay gritty. I get through this finish line and I'm on fire. It's like big smile on my face. It's like, and I want you to think about a time where you really went for it and what that was like for you. That's how I felt. You know, months of hard work and grit all came together in this beautiful moment. So I'm walking back to the family area and I'm like, that was a weird noise. That was a loud noise. Was that a trash can banging or car backfiring? I don't know what that is. Until I saw people's faces and I saw them running and fear in their eyes. So I'm trying to run to our hotel, even though I'm having a hard time just running anymore. And I get to my hotel and I open up my window and I see this. Here I am at the Boston Marathon when there's been a terrorist attack at the Boston Marathon. As you could imagine, it was a very difficult day. I remember asking myself, you know, in fact, it's like, I don't know if my race really mattered. What mattered most was my family, and what mattered second was my passion. And I remember asking myself, you know, why am I still here? What difference do I make in the world? And why do I do what I do? And these crucible moments teach us something really important about our passion and our purpose, right? All of these moments that you've had too have led you to where you are today. And it was like, why am I still here? What difference do I make? Why do I do what I do? Now, my friends, that day changed my life. Of any days in my life, that is the one moment that I'm like, I am playing small. I'm playing small with my life. I am not reaching my potential. I have so many other things that I'm trying to go after, but gosh, it was scary, right? All of them are scary. And so I make different decisions. I started working for the Vikings, even though I didn't play football. Okay? I wanted to work with an Olympic team. I'm like, all right, let's try to see if this can happen. I wanted to write a book, but all that was scary. So I don't think you have to be at the Boston Marathon bombing to really tap into what is it that you want and why do you do it? Right? This moment just made me every day choose courage, every day to go for these big, scary goals. And I'm grateful that I was there. So I want you to think about your why. And have a book, by the way, okay, first of all, before I do that, I'm like, okay, here it goes again. How can I see this difficulty is happening for me? And I think I just shared with you why I do think it's happened for me, right? Not to me. Because of all of these ways I've grown and I've learned. So I interviewed a guy on my podcast named Richard Leiter. Okay, Terry, he'd be a great speaker for the Optimist Club. He is from Minnesota. And when I got back to from the marathon, I read his book. It was the first thing I read because I was searching for my purpose. And I interviewed him on my podcast. If you listen to any episodes, I'd encourage you to listen to episode 333, okay? And you can get the high performance mindset anywhere you can listen to podcasts on your phone, there's a podcast app or online. And he says purpose is vital for our health, our happiness, and well-being. People who live their purpose live up to 7 to 10 years longer. And our purpose, again, is essential for us to be optimists. So, this is where the chat comes in. And I have this exercise. If we were face-to-face, I would tell you to turn to the person next to you. And I would tell you to say to that person, I do what I do 6 times, right? Because this helps us really start uncovering a little bit more about our purpose. And I'm going to encourage you to write this list out right after today's call or right as you're listening to me, is why do you do what you do? And what good comes from the work that you do? And then just answer the prompts so that 6 times. And I do what I do so I can provide really tangible strategies that work and that are based on research. I do what I do so I can be a great role model for my 2 boys, Carter and Blake, 7th and 9th grade. Scary. I do what I do so I can be a great role model for other women who want to work in sport, right? All of these reasons, right? And I can tap into any of these reasons when I really need more energy, or let's say I'm scared and I don't really want to go after that, the next big goal. I can tap into my why behind that. And if you connect with your why to your goals and your grit, it helps you continue to stay passionate about what you're doing. So now find the chat and I want you to tell me one of your so that's, okay? What's one reason you do what you do? Okay, go ahead and put that in the chat. You can just start it with I do, or you can just start it with so that, or I do what I do so that. Okay, I do what I do so that. Tell me why you do what you do. Right, here we go. I do what I do so that I'm good at leading others to help them make good decisions. I do what I do, Barb says, for kids to learn positive relational skills. I do what I do, Stephanie says, so that I can serve the community to the best of my ability. Why else do you do what you do? Keep on making those roll in the chat there. I do what I do so that I can make a difference in young women's lives and give them confidence to break the glass ceiling. I do what I do so that, here we go, I'm gonna make this bigger, that I can teach young people to develop emotional intelligence early in their life. I do what I do so that my students and graduates can realize the awesomeness that they have to offer in their professional career. I do what I do so visitors come to town and hospitality workers have jobs in hotels and restaurants. Thank you, Julie. I do what I do so that, let's see if I missed any. I measure people's emotional functioning to have better health outcomes. So I'm gonna encourage you, if you don't have your purpose statement or your whys written down, that you write your prompts to this. You could put it on, I have it on a grid board, by the way, in my office. You put it on your, just on a sticky note by your computer. So every day you can cultivate your grit and remind yourself of your purpose, which is one way to continue to be an optimist. All right, here's a few others. I do what I do so that seniors can get the best health insurance available to them. And I'm gonna encourage you today, not just to know what your purpose is, but to communicate it. Hey, this is what I mean by owning your purpose. I mean that you tell other people about it, all right? Do you tell other people about it? Do you use your purpose to inform your decisions? Like what to say yes to and what to say no to? And do you remind yourself of it every day? And again, this is vital for your health and happiness. I want to live 7 to 10 years longer, and I'm sure you do too. So this is one of the mental strategies you can use to continue to remind yourself of your purpose and why you do what you do. And there's a lot of people that struggle with this, by the way. They're not sure what their purpose is. And I think about, you know, before the Boston Marathon for me, I did not know what it was. So I think it's also about giving yourself some space and reflection. Maybe you read the section on purpose in my book, or you read Richard Leiter's book. Really, if you're unsure about what it is, to get more clarity on your purpose. Okay, so thanks for taking this journey with me today and helping me think about where I've come, and hopefully you're thinking about where you have come to. So the last part about continuing to develop our grit is this idea of having unwavering commitment to powerful and empowering self-talk. And self-talk just means like our inner voice inside our own head. But we have these things that get in our way, right? As we talked about at the beginning about things that get in our way of our potential, right? Fear, failure, doubt, uncertainty. All of these today we're gonna call as automatic negative thoughts. Okay, I got a plastic ant here to get your attention. And what I mean is they're just automatic. We don't always choose ants, but these ants are vital for our survival. In fact, at the beginning of COVID, I could imagine that just like me, you had a lot of automatic negative thoughts. Like, what's gonna happen here? Or, you know, can I even leave my house? Or am I safe? And those automatic negative thoughts likely kept you safe, right? They kept me safe. But we don't always have to believe these thoughts, nor should we, because many of these automatic negative thoughts are just lies. In fact, a recent research study said that 70% of what we say to ourselves is a repeat of what we said yesterday, and 70% is negative, right? So we're not very optimistic as people in general. So we need really powerful strategies to live and let go, to reset. I was listening to this interview of a downhill skier named Michaela Schifrin. And she's ranked number one in the world right now. And this interview was asking Michaela, she said, you know, Michaela, when you're on the top of the slope, What do you think about when you're on the top of the slope? And again, remember, she's number one in the world. Now, if you were her sports psychologist, okay, let's put that hot on you for now. If you were her sports psychologist, put in the chat what you think Michaela should be thinking about when she's on the top of the slope. Okay? If you were her optimist coach, what would you tell her to think about as she's ready to go down the hill 70 miles an hour? Okay, so great. Heather said I would tell her to envision the finish line, or I would tell her to think about her starting technique, or I would tell her to think about winning or how she wanted to feel at the end. Joel said, I would just tell her to breathe. Hey, I am enough. I can do this. It's time to succeed. Great. All of these are wonderful answers. Now, what Michaela said is she said, well, I'm on the top of the slope, by the way. And she said, I have an angel on one shoulder and a devil on the other. And this angel is like, I'm going to crush it today. I'm going to win. She envisions the finish line. And then she said, and the devil says to me, you're going to die. Okay. And this interviewer was like, what? You think about dying? You're like number one in the world and you think about dying. And she said, well, of course I think about dying because like I'm human. And I want you to think about how that relates to you. I think we can all know that we got this angel and this devil. And it's all about which one you feed, right? What's the angel want to say to you about yourself and about the opportunities moving forward, right? And then we have to quiet that other voice on a side of our shoulder. And maybe sometimes just breathe. Like I think someone said in the chat, just take a breath and clear our mind. That's actually what Michaela said. She said, to clear that devil and angel, I have to take a deep breath and clear my mind. And so we need some strategies like that to be able to combat the negativity and channel this optimistic, continue to do that. So we all have these automatic negative thoughts. What do we do instead? I told you a few times where I've had them in college, for example. Here's another example when they were a little loud because I was really pushing myself. So maybe you have seen Dancing with the Stars on NBC. If you've seen that, go ahead and put that in the chat if you've watched Dancing with the Stars. So we have this competition in Mankato called Dancing with the Mankato Stars. Oh yeah. And I was asked to dance with this guy named Wade. Now Wade is a hip hop dancer. And I'm like, all right, I can handle hip hop. Until I met with him and he said, well, Cindra, I actually do dubstep. I'm like, oh, I don't know what dubstep is. So the number one mistake I made was I went home and I Googled dubstep. And I was like, I can't dance like this. It's like electronic music with electronic movements and I can't dubstep. Of course, because I was listening and watching all of these like professionals do dubstep. And a couple weeks into learning this dance, Wade pulls me aside and I thought maybe he was going to fire me. And Wade pulls me aside and he says, Cindra, you know, we've only learned 30 seconds of the dance. Now, something's not working. We got 3 more minutes to learn in 2 more weeks. So I'm like, man, this is not working out. I was so nervous for this competition, way more nervous than my oral defense for my dissertation. The most nervous I'd ever been was for Dancing with the Mankato Stars because I'm a runner, not a dancer. My husband and I, for our wedding, he had this great idea to do this beautiful dance, you know, the first dance. And so he signed us up for dancing lessons and he abandoned me after 3 dance lessons. He's like, she can't do it. And then he goes, you know, Cindra, you dance like Elaine from Seinfeld, you know, Elaine, right? I got that right. So I have this running through my head, like I'm a runner, not a dancer. So I go to this conference and I'm like, I got to get my mind right. I have like 3 days at this conference. And actually this conference was all about continuing to grow our mindset. And I see this guy up ahead of me. And he's the Dancing with the Stars legend, right? So if you have any idea who you think I'm talking about, who is the Dancing with the Stars legend? Go ahead and put that in the chat. Who do you think I met? right in front of me in this line to register for this conference. Derek Hasselhoff, that's a good one. Okay, Derek Hoff, all right. So I meet Derek Hoff and I go up to Derek and I'm like, Derek, we're doing this great thing, but I am so stuck because I can't learn dubstep. And Derek said to me two things. And he said, Cindra, sounds like you're telling me all the reasons you can't. And don't we do that all, right? We tell ourselves all the reasons we can't. And he said, you know, the best dancers dance with their heart, not their head. And he said, you know, your heart is where you're living with passion and grit and purpose. And your head is where you're telling yourself, you're overthinking it, you're getting in your own head. But when you're really in your heart, you can see new levels of potential. So I'm like, all right, well, I thought he was going to give me all these like tips, but mindset tips right back at me. And so I get back. And all of a sudden, Wade was like, wow, you look a lot more free. And I was like, yeah, I feel free. And he said, let's go for it. So we did learn the dance. That day, we got a 29 out of 30. And I shattered my own limiting beliefs about myself and my ability. And that day, only that day, I could do the dance. If you'd like to watch it, it's on YouTube, by the way. It's not perfect, but it was the best I could do in that moment. And if I was in front of you, I can't do dubstep today. So just to let you know, I uncovered all of these. And the thing that I most learned about this moment was the importance of really what we're talking about related to ourselves. And what we think about ourselves, we become. I was thinking there's no way that I could dance, right? And literally that night before, I'm like, dance with your heart, dance with your heart. That's what I was channeling that day, was my heart, my head. And so this taught me a really important lesson about being intentional with our self-talk so we can reach our potential. And this summer, as I've been working with the United States track and field team, there's these interesting, amazing conversations that I've had. And every athlete, when I first meet with them, I ask them two questions. What do you really, really want? Okay, what do you really want? And what do you need to believe about yourself to get there? What do you really, really want? And what do you need to believe about yourself to get there? And because, like I said, what you think about yourself, you become. What you think about yourself, you become. So we need to make sure we're really intentional and powerful with that self-talk. And when you think about an optimist, all right, this is the next question for the chat. I'd love to hear your responses here. What do you think an optimist should believe about themselves and the world? What do you think an optimist should believe about themselves and the world? If what you think about yourself, you become, what do you think that an optimist should believe? I'd love to hear your thoughts in the chat. Maybe things like good things are coming my way, or I absolutely can do that. Anything is possible. I think sometimes like watch me, right? That's what the best athletes do, is they're like, hey, watch me. I can do it. If someone else can do it, I can do it too. Where's the opportunity here? What's the gift in this struggle? What can I be grateful for? Denny said, yes, they live the optimist creed. So this powerful conversation I had that I want to tell you a little bit about, and I have this woman's name to tell you her story. I have her permission to tell you her story. This picture here is of a woman named Quenisha Burks. She goes by Q. 3 weeks before the Olympic trials, I started working with Q, and I went to a track meet in San Diego at the Olympic Training Center. It was this elite track meet, all the best athletes in the world in the US were there, and Q got last in the long jump. Hey, she's really talented. She was an All-American at Alabama, but she was struggling. She was struggling with an injury. She was struggling a little bit with her confidence and her belief. And I asked Q, what do you need to believe about yourself to reach your goals? And her goal was to become an Olympian. The Olympic trials were in 3 weeks. And again, she has to be in the top three. She's ranked 11th. So nobody expected Q to do anything at the Olympic trials. And later on, she told me, she said, you know, Cindra, that first conversation, you believed that I could become an Olympian more than I believed I could become an Olympian. And isn't that true that sometimes other people can believe more about our potential than we can actually see our own selves? And so that's why it's so important that we show and demonstrate and verbalize our belief in other people. And also to help us uncover our own limiting beliefs that we can continue to have, right? So that we can be and reach our potential. So I don't know what Q does with this conversation. I keep on working with her, but I don't really know the impact, right? Just like we don't really know the impact of the work we do until someone tells us. And I want to show you what Q did with this conversation. Because I asked her, you know, what do you need to believe about yourself, right? And we brainstormed and we said, well, she needs to believe that she can perform on demand. She needs to believe that she's one of the best in the United States. She needs to believe that under pressure, she can make it happen. And at the end, she said, I need to believe I am an Olympian. So this is what Q does with this conversation. And I hope it inspires you to think about your potential. And hold on, I think I might have to stop sharing my screen and reshare it so that we have some audio. So just give me a second here, because I didn't hear audio. There's sound. All right, here we go. Venetia Burks.
I will make the 2021 Olympics, okay? I'm speaking of an Olympian. I'm going to be an Olympian. I'm going to the Olympics. I'm claiming it now. It's June the 7th. I will be an Olympian. I'm going to make the Olympic team. I will be an Olympian. I'm going to be an Olympian. Today is the day. I told you, I'm an Olympian. I'm an Olympian. I told you the power of the tongue. I've been telling myself this for every single day that I'm gonna be Olympian. Now look at me. Who's an Olympian? Me. The power of the tongue. I'm going to be an Olympian.
Adorable, right? What's your reaction to that? Put that in the chat. What do you think about that? I'd love to hear what you think. Okay. I want to see the chat here. So I'm just going to. Yeah. Never giving up. Awesome. Yeah. Tears of joy for her. Every time I watch it, I'm like, oh gosh, I'm going to lose it. Again, no idea the conversation that I had and the impact that it made. And what I love about Q's story is that she decided to be intentional with what she thought about herself. She didn't really believe it, but she had to continue to say that, right? And she did it on video to continue to be her best, right? And believe these powerful things about herself. So what do you need to believe about yourself right now? What do you need to believe about yourself that's gonna help you continue to reach your potential and stay gritty? And I am is the best way to talk to yourself. So maybe you need to believe, you know, things like I am confident or I am enough, right? That's where it's underlying everyone's self-talk is this belief they're not, right? So I am enough or I'm happy or I'm amazing or I am an optimist or I am innovative or a hard worker. I want you to kind of think about what you want to tell about to yourself, right? Because great comments in the chat here. Another demonstration of the power of positive self-talk. If you can see it, you can achieve it. Yes. And so the idea is to continue to move forward with that idea, right? And I'd love for you right now just to write down what are two or three beliefs that you need to adopt about yourself. Maybe you don't quite believe yet, but you know is going to help you step into your potential. All right, so I am going to end today. Woo! All right, I'd love for you to check out the High Performance Mindset Podcast. It's free anywhere you can get podcasts. So just want to mention that again. Thanks for the comments there in the chat. Thank you, Gary, for putting that in the chat there. And if you'd like to grab a book, I'm going to give you a free ship code. You put free ship, all one word, capital letters, into beyondgrit.com. So you go over to beyondgrit.com and go ahead and put free ship into that code, or into the, you know, the code part. Would love for you to continue to read and continue to develop your own mindset. Okay, so if you could tell me what the most important thing was that we shared in today, I would love to hear what you took away. And as I do that, I'm going to just share a final comment. And, you know, there are athletes that, and people that we work with, right? People that you work with, right? You don't necessarily know the impact. And sometimes those people teach you more about yourself and life than maybe you know, and you, you know, you've taught them. One woman who taught me way more about life than I taught her was a woman named Gabe Grunewald. So if you look at this picture, she has a scar on her stomach. And she was a track and field athlete from the University of Minnesota who ran professionally for Brooks. She was diagnosed with cancer 3 times. And she hired me to help her get to the Olympics, but cancer got in her way. One day when she was going through cancer treatment in New York City, her husband were running around Central Park, and they meet this guy who's kind of heckling at them and saying, you know, hey, I want to learn how to run, but I don't know how. And this guy was Chip Gaines. So Chip and Gabe pair up, and they raise $500,000 for rare cancer research while Gabe trains Chip for his first marathon. And Gabe tweets, you know, after the race, she said, you know, I think Chip could have ran faster if he wouldn't have worn his tool belt. But the thing I want to leave you with is Gabe passed away about 2 years ago. And the thing, you know, today we're talking about reaching our potential, moving forward, using these optimistic strategies and being courageous to really reach our best. And she has this powerful statement I want to leave you with. And she said, being brave for me means not giving up on the things that make me feel alive. We talked about that today. What is your why? Why do you do what you do? What is it that you're really working towards? And moving towards that with courage and bravery is key. That's the thing I want to leave you with, is continue to be courageous optimists. And thank you, Terry and Don and Jerry, for having me today.
Cindra, thank you so much for your presentation. If you want to stop your share, that would be helpful.
You betcha.
Thank you so much. It was great. Boy, just everyone, let's give her a big round of applause. You can see us try to clap. I really appreciate that.